Okay, good morning. Are we sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin. Morning, everyone. Welcome to the session on emerging units. In Richard Thaler's book, the most recent one, Misbehaving, he recounts the story of the time that Daniel Kahneman said to him that 40 was the time at which you can stop saying that somebody was promising. So when I read that, I felt quite comforted. I was like, great, I've got a few years left to become promising and then to enjoy it. And then at BX 2015 last year, Max Baserman was kind enough to name-check me when he was on stage by saying that I was doing an okay job of looking after junior people, so it was slightly disappointing that I'd skipped through that entire phase and was now an old person. So that was a particularly great moment for my life, and then sort of becomes a question about at what point do we say a behavioral insights team is established and past and kind of old news. And since I'm now chairing a session on emerging units, I guess that my time is done. I remember when we were the future and no longer, but this is fine. I'm British. We're accustomed to our former colonies and Germans sort of starting things which we did and then doing them much better. And basically, we just fade into obsolescence. So this is the beginning of me fading into obsolescence. Those of you who don't know, by the way, I'm Michael Sanders. Most of you didn't know my name, and I've already said that I'm obsolete. So don't bother committing that to memory. So this morning, we have three excellent speakers, in addition to this mediocre speaker. We have Dr. Andrea Schneider, who's the Deputy Head of Staff of Policy Planning in the German Chancellery. We have Professor Michael Hiscox, who is the Clarence Dillon Professor of International Affairs at the Harvard Department of Government and the Director of the Behavioral Economics Team of Australia, which I think I said right. Excellent. And Liz Hardy, who's the Head of the Behavioral Insights Team at the Privy Council Office of the Government of Canada, which is great because those are all words I'm familiar with working in the British government. So they're all going to give about 15-minute talks about the work they've been doing, the work they're going to be doing, and then there'll be time for a superabundance of questions afterwards after you've been inspired to ask questions by all of the excellent things that they've told you. So I'm going to not do very much talking at all. I'm going to hand straight over to Andrea.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thank you for this opportunity to take you along a journey which has been really inspiring, very interesting, and also very challenging of how to set up a team within a government in order to make a strong impact of science for citizens. And this is the simple formula we want to like to summarize our approach is a strong orientation on the citizens, that he is the one who should benefit. So in this initial stage, we do not focus so much on business and organizational, but on the citizen and his benefit. And it's about evaluating the impact of what politics, of our policies, what they do. So government with impact is a not so nice translation of the German word, which is Wirksamkeit, efficacy, I just learned from some of you. And so what does that mean? It all started a couple of years ago when we proposed to the Chancellor this project, and it took us three examples and 3 minutes, and she said, yes, well, sure, this is how we should proceed. So we just gave her a couple of examples of what the BIT in UK has been doing, of what Mind Lab in Denmark has been doing, or the Joint Research Center of the European Commission, and then we had her support, which is still there and very helpful. And we had this little passage in the coalition treaty, which is very important in German politics, because 6 weeks after the elections, or at least six weeks, the parties who will be forming the coalition are discussing what to do in the next 4 years. It's all written down. It's been 8 pages in the 1950s. It's about 150 pages these days. And there can be some policies added to that, but you want to make sure that everything that's written in the contract is really implemented. So this is why it's so important for us. Where is this team? It's based in the Staff for Policy Planning in the German Chancellery. This is really a German version of a mixture of a planning unit, a strategy unit, a communication unit, and so on. We're a very small team. We used to be only 5. Today, we're up to 20 because we do different projects, and this team Government with Impact is one of these teams. From speech writing to strategy and to developing and testing new government tools, we did a lot of different things, and it's kind of a bit of an experimentation lab for the Chancellor. So what are different things we do? I'd like to talk just shortly on that to give you an idea where we're heading to, because what we do with our team Government with Impact relates to all of this. We've been doing an expert and national dialogue on Germany's future a couple of years ago, where we really wanted to make good use of the available knowledge, the available expertise which is out there, not only in science, but also citizens. They are the experts of their own lives. So to ask them, what should we change? What should government do? Also, we have the strategy going on still on well-being in Germany. We did a national dialogue and asked what's important for you? What's quality of life for you personally and for us in Germany? From that on, we now write a report and find some indicators for policies to be aligned much stronger to the priorities that the citizens have and not so much what politics thinks that the priorities are. We started with a government foresight training program for all of the governments to strengthen the foresight capacities and a couple of other things. So what I'm going to talk now is how does that government strategy, the strategy in the team government with impact fits all in there. Just a short history. Where we came from, the coalition treaty I already told you. A couple of months later, we presented our approach to the heads of all the departments. It was on the level of state secretaries and heads of divisions. We invited David Halpern to just give lots of examples of what they've been doing in UK. For another appointment, we invited David Mayer from the European Commission, from the Joint Research Center then, to give some examples, and by that, with simple examples, bring across the idea. So we didn't talk so much about methodology and so on, but just giving an idea of where this approach can lead to. We had very good discussions on that, very shortly on manipulation for sure, on how to set norms, what's the role of the government versus the role of individual, what's the role of administration and so on. Very good. So then we asked them to give us some ideas, where can we help you? We didn't propose any project. Our approach is to ask the ministries, what are the projects you are doing where we can be helpful? So they send us a lot of projects and ideas, and then happened what always happens in administration. You think you can start a team, and then, bureaucracy kicks in. And it took us about a year for the team to actually be there, get started, and so on. In February, we started with a team of three scientists from different backgrounds. We stressed very strongly that they were strong in methodologies, did a lot of field studies, came from different school backgrounds so that they could kind of check on each other and compare methodology and make best use of all the different approaches. When we got started in February last year, we already had press coverage for half a year. This is because the job postings were out there, and although usually these are really boring information, one of our rainbow papers picked it up and said, well, oh, wow, now psychologists are hired by the German Chancellor in order to put the German nation on a couch, lit a candle, and make everybody happy. So this is how we got started. Half a year of press coverage without even having a team. And it's a bit our situation. We couldn't just start quietly, you know, get started, explain our approach, start with our field studies, get the data, and then analyze it and so on. We're already under suspicion of being very manipulative just because we can't talk about anything. There is nothing finished yet, so it must be really secretive. That's a bit of a, was a difficult start. Anyway, in summer, then finally we started the first project, and but we have very long-term projects, take a lot of time to prepare and data to gather and so on, so we'll only have some results end of this year. Where are we going to go? Our primary objective is really to take these 2.5 years we have within this government term to have a good array of different projects on different levels of government to show that this approach really can work and can be applied. And we want to present it, to be sure to initiate public discussion. Also, we would like to develop a concept of how to institutionalize it in a broader way, where it is now in the German Chancellery. It doesn't have to stay that. It's very good for a beginning because we have the backing of the Chancellor, but it does not necessarily have to stay there. What is our approach? We don't talk about better choices for citizens, but better informed choices, and this is a very strong difference. We have a strong capability approach, an empowerment approach, so there's a lot of the well-known nudges we would not use because we really want for the long-term effect of building up people's capabilities and providing information that's useful and can be used for them. We want to ensure that service delivery is better, so if a formula, if an application is filled out in a wrong way, it's not because people don't know how to do it properly or are stupid, it's because the form, the application is not well designed. We want to ensure in the long run that the impact of policies is raised. How do we want to do that? It's by really changing the culture within the government. This is not only about a couple of nudges. This is really about the culture of creating a learning organization that from developing a policy to does it really work, has a feedback loop. Everybody involved in the process of designing a law, of implementing it, of evaluating it, all these people usually are different ones, but they need to know, why did he design it this way? Did it really work? So we want to bring everybody in this feedback loop. And that's a change of culture where you need to find different ways to approach it. So those I can't talk about here, but we have more ideas of how to do that. Our main perspective, as I said, is a citizen, and the orientation is very important. Usually in Germany, we're a very strong lawyer-focused administration, and what we do is design policy options, and someone else implements it, and the citizen more or less is out of this equation. So starting with a citizen is a good way to change behavior, to change culture. Our theoretical foundation is social science, including behavioral, and our empirical foundation is RCTs. So in order to explain what we do to the ministries, we always tell them, well, what we do is not the usual approach to research. You give a question out to research and you get back a study and analysis where sometimes your question is answered, but sometimes not because research is independent. What we do is hand-tailored research within the government for you. Give us your questions and we'll try to come up with the answers. We want to increase policy options, so it's not only about laws and regulations and incentives, but we do not exclude those. We use really all the tools in the box. But we want to increase those options. We want to offer behaviorally informed policy options and do the impact evaluation. In future, what we would like to do is really go more into training also. Just the difference between causality, correlation, and plausibility to explain to a lawyer takes some time. It's not part of the education. So we have to do it later on. Everything we do is based on cooperation. So we always have a partner within a federal agency or a department who's in charge. He also pays for the whole thing and takes full responsibility, more or less. What is our responsibility is to do a sound analysis, to help design options or design the options ourselves, and to test them, but also to evaluate. Sometimes a third party comes in because we just need someone to implement things. Here's how the process goes. The goals usually are not set by us, they are not set by research, they are set by a democratically chosen parliament. Most of them you can find in the coalition treaty. So that's important to stress. And we do the analysis, the alternative policy options, and the testing. The implementation is the task of a third party or the agency. But what we then always do is come back with an evaluation. We don't want one-term effects. And this is what you get very often. You change a format, people see, oh, wow, it did change. But will that be persistent? Will that be sustainable? So we try to make sure by this way of evaluation and also in order to create that feedback cycle I was talking about. There are some distinctive features in Germany. We have our strong departmental principal, so they're in charge, said. We have federal state, so the contact between the citizen is much more on the basis of municipalities, so this is why we go and work with them. Our primary focus is consistency of law. This is why a change of the culture is so important to bring in the implementation side and so on. Our evaluation culture is a bit weak, so it really needs explaining to do why impact matters. We talk a lot about limits of states, about our concept of state and his role vis-a-vis the role of the individual, and the role of the administration as well. In our approach, the government is the one deciding on the legitimacy of policy interventions. This is not up to us in the administration. And we have to see that any policy option is on that scale between highly interventionist and low interventionist. And the same is true for any behavioral informed policy option. So it's really a discussion we have to go through for every single intervention we go to. Where are we at the scale? For us in the team, we focus on low intervention, on better informed choices versus better choices. We don't know what's best for the citizen. The citizen knows what's best for him. So we only choose those projects where we help to giving more information, better information, but we leave out the decision, what's the best choice for him. So if you look at these different defaults, double-sided print, you wouldn't talk so much about the legitimacy of the intervention. But if you look at the opt-out rule of organ donation, we talk about a change of how we look at society. This is something different if my organs belong to you than if they belong to me. So this is something you would not do without a public discussion in a society, without the public, long, intense debate in the parliament. This is where we completely leave out. If politicians decide they want to go that road, we're going to be helpful with providing insight, but we would never suggest that. So the role of administration has to be really looked at very, very carefully in that sense. So there are a couple of overlaps that all have to do with impact and efficacy, where we can see the different conferences also going on. Every bubble is a conference you can go to if you want to make your research effective. Thank you.
All the talks and then questions. So our next speaker will be Michael Hiscox, who is from, as I said, the Behavioural Economics team of the Australian Government. As with Australians in general, we're expecting him to dominate over the UK for about 30 years and then have an unfortunate fall from grace. That was a cricket joke for those of you who are in North America.
Thank you, Michael. So it's a pleasure to be here today. I think I listed this as my second choice for the breakout panel for right now, just to see what would happen, and I got assigned to this panel anyway, so I think that's probably good. System works. So it's great to be here. I'm going to just talk a little bit about how we've set up the behavioral economics team in the Australian government, and I think we'll cover some very similar themes to our Canadian and German counterparts. So BETA, as we refer to ourselves, is the Australian government's first central agency unit that is focused on applications of behavioural insights to improving policy and program design and service delivery in Australia. The ground was kind of seeded. You know, we actually ran the first behavioural exchange, 2014, in Sydney, and that and the work that the UK's BIT team was doing in New South Wales at the time and is still doing had sort of prepared the ground really well for us in terms of building support for the creation of a new central behavioural insights team in the Australian government. So it took a little while. We officially launched on February 1 of this year, but the development took about a year and a half of solid cultivation before we had all the support and everything in place. We are hosted by the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet in Canberra, but we actually refer to ourselves and are effectively a joint initiative of 14 agencies or departments across the federal government. So that's really important to us, and it's something that's a little bit unique about us, I think, compared to other units, and that is that we are co-funded by the agencies, so we have some funding that's central funding from Prime Minister and Cabinet, but all the agencies and departments that are our partners actually put in funding to support our work and pre-commit to doing projects with us. So we expect, and are sort of written up this up in our plan, that we'll do up to two major RCTs with each of the partners over the next 12 months. And we have a timeline that looks ahead with our funding to June of next year. We expect to have a discussion about continuation of our funding and the unit's work at the end of this year to sort of set us up for the future. But officially, our timeline is through to the June of next year, and we expect to deliver about two projects for each of the 14 partners and have sort of committed to that ahead of time, and they've committed to work with us. So I'll talk a little bit about this in a minute as a unique characteristic of our unit, I think, because it has advantages and disadvantages in that there's a strong expectation, there's strong buy-in from each of our partners to work with us, and there's a sense of urgency about that from all sides in the sense that we all expect and need to deliver in the next 12 months. But that also does create a sense of urgency and some anxiety about our ability to deliver and our need for to match demand with capacity. So that's one of our big challenges. And I'm appointed officially as the first director of BETA. I'm on 2 years of public service leave from my position at Harvard. There's a uniqueness about this, I think, in the sense that I'm not a civil servant. So I'm learning on the job about how to be a civil servant. And I have a fantastic managing director, Tara Oliver, who's here with me today, who is essentially giving me tutorials on how to be a civil servant as I go, and you know what's the difference between a first assistant secretary and an assistant secretary and a deputy secretary and an executive assistant. You know, those are really important distinctions that I just always forget. So she is helping me greatly, and we have a team, we're assembling a team and hiring actually at the moment still, a team of policy advisors, behavioral economists, and psychologists. So we have quite a mix in our team. I applied for some hardship. I thought there'd be hardship benefits for having you move down to Australia again and live in this place, but it's not that tough. There are dangerous animals. I'd be very, very careful. So I thought I would get, some sympathy for doing the work, but no, everyone thinks I've got a really good gig for 2 years, and I'm very happy about it. So the mission is very similar to the missions of all the nudge units, I guess, in the sense that what we want to do is build capability across the civil service to use behavioral insights in policy design and program design. We want to do a whole bunch of projects where we demonstrate the importance of this and work with our partner agencies to improve policies and programs and show that it affects outcomes in good ways and brings benefits to Australian citizens. The capacity building that we've focused on in the 5 months or so since we launched has been fairly intense. I've been running 1 and 2 day courses in Canberra for classes of up to about 100 civil servants from across our member, our partner departments, in how to do randomized control trials and what behavioral economics is and what are the key insights and how they've been applied. So we've done a lot of training, and I think that's been really good because it's helped spread the word, evangelize a little bit at the same time that it's been building capability and getting people prepared to actually develop projects with us. So we think that's been quite good. We're also getting secondments from our partner agencies. We have about 5, I think, at the moment sitting with us, and we expect to get more soon, and that's terrific because they get on-the-job experience working on projects with us, and they add to our capacity to deliver as well. We're working on these projects fairly actively. I'll talk about some of them now. We're working on, again, looking at about two per partner and thinking about timelines, thinking about how we choose those, given that we need some quick wins, but we also don't want to be seen as doing easy stuff. We want to do some challenging things. And so I'll talk about how we've made some selections in a moment. And then one of the things that I think came up earlier, perhaps David Halpin just mentioned this, was about establishing links, I think it was Michael Congdon, about links between academia and policymakers. And in Australia, we think that this is a big contribution that we can make, is to, we're doing some matchmaking between behavioral economists and psychologists who are in academia in Australia and elsewhere as well, to bring them onto projects, to get them, to try and build that bridge between academia and policymaking, with a specific focus on behavioral economics and applied psychology. We work pretty much along the same lines as UK's BIT team, I think, in terms of how we develop projects. We do a lot of data analysis. We probably don't have that much time for most of our projects to do a lot of time-intensive qualitative work in the field to diagnose behavioral problems and do innovative designs. We're trying to get on with it pretty quickly. So we're picking areas where it's very data-rich in terms of behavioral patterns and outcomes. And we do a lot of that analysis first. Then we think about, you know, what we think are the most important behavioral challenges for individuals making decisions in fraught circumstances, how we might be able to improve design to help them get across the intention-action gap, all those kinds of standard things, and then designing the RCTs, and that's crunch time. So I'll talk a little bit about a couple of examples in a moment. Michael started by talking about youth. I was going to say that, I have a colleague who always says that when referring to junior job candidates, that potential is an amazing thing. You know, it's potentially limitless. You know, no one knows quite how to assess it, but we're in that stage where we have a lot of potential, but we don't have results yet. So it's sort of exciting and also a little stressful. Very quickly, I only have a couple of minutes. Our immediate priorities are building more capacity to match all this demand that we have to deliver projects. So we're doing a lot of training, and as I said, we're doing a lot of matchmaking with academics who might be interested, including PhD students, who might be interested in co-authoring or co-PIing on projects with us. We have this big challenge that I think we'll all talk about, which is selecting the right projects. And the impulse or the incentive for us to find some quick wins that will prove to be good demonstration projects that will help us demonstrate our value and provide service to our partners who are expecting it. But we don't want to be seen as the unit that just does the easy things, easy, quick things. We want to take on some tougher challenges like domestic violence in Indigenous communities. So I think we'll have some mixture of long-term, harder, bigger projects, and then shorter term, slightly easier projects. And there's a bunch of issues that I think we all have in common, things like ethics review, how we set up a process for that, for all our RCTs, thinking about how we merge government administrative data to use in our trials and how we get access to that, under what conditions, that's a big issue. And then we have a very strong commitment to transparency, so we want to pre-register all our trials. In general terms, not with all the details that give the game away before we do the trial, but then we want to, most clearly, we want to establish an expectation for full reporting, and we want to do that for all of our trials, and that's an issue that will require a bit of culture change in Canberra in terms of what bureaucracies typically publish and disclose. I think I have one more slide. As I said, this is kind of a two-sided sword in the sense that it's great that we don't have to go around knocking on doors, begging with departments to work for us or work with us. They've already signed up. They've already put money in. So we have that commitment. But that creates a strong expectation that we are, you know, we have to provide service pretty soon to all these departments. We have to manage those relationships and expectations, and we have to provide some sense of equality in service across all those partners. So that's challenging. And those partners are very different in terms of their underlying, you know, capacity at the moment, their skills. Some of them have their own behavioral insights teams already. Some of them are just learning about behavioral insights. So there's a lot of variance there in the types of projects they would like us to do. So that's a big negotiation and discussion. As I said, transparency is quite challenging, and we're trying to hold a hard line on being very transparent because we think it is the best way to address these political concerns about us being psyops or some kind of, secret manipulators. We want full transparency for its political value as well as for the value to the whole research community in terms of reporting on what works and what does not work. And then our time horizon. It's pretty tight, and that is creating a lot of momentum and a little bit of anxiety at the same time. I think that's it. Thank you.
We're all really looking forward to this November, the prospect of America being made great again. Last November, I think it's fair to say, Canada has embarked on an adventure in making government cool again. So I'm looking forward to hearing what you guys are up to.
So good morning, everyone. Thanks so much. So I work in the Government of Canada in Privy Council office, and I head up the Behavioural Science Group there at Privy Council. I need a clicker. So the government has an ambitious agenda. We're really focused right now on building a better evidence base to support policy advice. Also, you might have heard that there is a very strong focus on looking at implementation. So we just set up a delivery and results unit right in Privy Council, whose job it is to make sure that we actually are looking at the implementation of our policy and programs as we develop them. We're also looking at engaging citizens, so we're starting to do more open consultations with citizens to determine the best course of action for our policies and programs that we roll out, which is a change from the past. And so I work in the Innovation Hub, and I think what might be a little bit different than what we heard this morning is that we're a multidisciplinary team. So I am the behavioral science sort of group there, but we also have expertise in design, design thinking, and data, which is quite helpful. So when we're all sitting in one space, we can sort of look at what is the best solution. Sometimes it is behavioral science, sometimes it's a design approach. There are times when we'll go through a design thinking approach, and that'll lead us to some sort of behavioral science, behavioral intervention at the end. And we have experts in those fields. We have a very small team, though. Very small, I feel like I need to mention that. In behavioral science group, there's two of us, for instance. I'm half the team. In data, there's one. Design, we have three. So hopefully the goal is that we will grow slowly. We've been around since last February when we were announced. My team was established in September, so not even quite a year yet. So the hub, as we call ourselves, we play three central roles in government. We are the central group, so we do see ourselves as a connector. By that I mean we connect departments to expertise, either outside, so academics. So if a department comes to us with a problem, we can connect them to an academic, for instance, who specializes in that area. We also act as a resource where we help departments complete projects ourselves, so we use internal expertise to help with that. We also see ourselves as an innovation catalyst, and by that I mean we sort of are driving some of the new ideas and new innovations that are happening in government, looking at government priorities and seeing where we can apply some new tools to solve some existing problems. So behavioral insights in Canada. So just to give you a little idea, behavioral insights has been happening in Canada for many, many years. So about 4 years ago, I set up the province's behavioral insights team. So the province of Ontario has a behavioral science team. They've been running randomized control trials for a few years now in areas like tax collection, organ donation, shift to online. Some of their trials are available on their public website if you are interested. They are also a very small team, but planning to grow. And then we have my team in the Central Innovation Hub. There are also labs in the federal government popping up that are looking at behavioral science and behavioral economics and how they can use those tools in the work that they do. We are currently setting up a behavioral science community of practice as well in Canada. As far as we know, we've got the province of Ontario and the government of Canada, but we are starting to hear rumblings that other provinces might come on board, so we're trying to see if we can sort of link that work and link those provinces together to assist in any way possible to help set up their teams. So behavioral insights. So this is sort of how we talk about it in the government of Canada, how it's an effective solution that often costs nothing to implement. It's also an alternative to complex legislation and costly marketing. I often say to clients, it does not replace. It's just another tool in our toolkit in situations where perhaps we can look at a behavioral science intervention versus going straight to regulation or even like an ad campaign on TV. And as I mentioned, it's increasing uptake in Canada. Canada Revenue Agency has been also running trials for quite some time. Some really impressive work coming out of their shop, as well as Employment and Social Development Canada. So this will just give you a sense of sort of our process and how we apply behavioral science. So we sort of have a three-step process. The department will come to us and say we have this challenge. We'd like, for instance, more citizens to go online. So our first sort of step is to understand the problem. We work with them to determine what the barriers are. Why are people not following through with that particular behavior? We look at things like, how is the transaction, for instance? I often say that the nudge can be excellent, but if the process behind that nudge is terrible, people are still not going to follow through with that behavior. So we look at sort of how is the process? What does the website look like? How do you move through the transaction? I think that's a really important point. I think sometimes we think we'll just throw a nudge on it and we'll solve all our problems. But I think in government, we definitely need to look at the back end system and how can we improve that to make sure it's helping citizens achieve what we'd like them to achieve. So we understand, go through that process, and then we design multiple solutions. In an ideal world, we run randomized control trials wherever possible. Some situations don't allow that. Data's not there, or we just can't accurately test or track what the behavior is. But wherever possible, we do set it up as an RCT so that we know for sure what worked and what didn't work. So some examples of what we're working on right now. So I can't give you too many details, sort of like the other presenters. We're new, but we are looking at supporting students in post-secondary education, and this is around student loans specifically, and how we can support them making first payments, preventing defaulting and defaults on their loans, which is a significant problem, especially as a young person. You don't want to be defaulting on loans in your early 20s. It could affect you later on. We're also, this one's very exciting, focusing on diversity and recruitment, so seeing whether we can support women and in entering the public service in specific targeted areas. And this is a very, I would say, one of the longer term studies that we're looking at, which I think will be really exciting. And a third one I can talk about today is increasing response rate for Canadian surveys. So in Canada, we have the census. We have a lot of surveys that we send to Canadians that we would like them to fill out. It obviously helps build our evidence base in Canada. So encouraging people to fill out those surveys, helping them understand why that's important, what the benefits are. So some opportunities and challenges. So some of the things we sort of say right now, because it's early days, we're focused on the low-hanging fruit. But like Michael, we also want to make sure that we're looking at longer range things, but we look at program uptake. So number of clients or citizens taking advantage of a particular service or program, helping increase that. So compliance, increasing the compliance rate. So that could be, for instance, tax or environmental compliance. We are looking at some applications to businesses. There's a lot of research out there with nudging individuals. We are also looking at organizations and how we can help influence them, especially since we work at the federal level. And then channel shifting, as I mentioned, more getting people out of our service centers and onto the online system. Cost savings, there's a variety of reasons why that is advantageous. Some of the challenges, so I think we're very well positioned right now where we do have senior leadership support, which is amazing. There is a movement towards experimentation, and in the mandate letters that have been released publicly, there is a commitment that the Government of Canada will experiment. So right now we're sort of trying to define what do we mean by that. Do we always mean an RCT? We don't mean trying a new website. So just sort of helping departments understand what that is and then understanding why experimentation should be the path forward and why it's important. Data. I'd say one of the biggest challenges for us is data sharing. So one department holds one data set, they can't share it with another department because of the legislation around that. So looking at how we can make that an easier process, because that will really help make it easier for us to test things and know what works. And then organizational commitment. Some departments, I would say, are there. Some are just slowly starting to get there. I joke that 90% of my job is a sales pitch, where I go and sort of, you know, try and convince departments to work with us and to try something new. And again, we're getting there. It's getting easier, but I'd still put that in the bucket of challenges. So what's next? So some of the things I'm really excited about, so having worked at the provincial level and now I work at the federal level, is combining those levels of government and solving problems together. And I think that's really exciting. And I also, you know, I hope to see in about 5 years' time, even like adding the municipal layer, and you think about how you can solve a problem working at all three levels of government, I think it gets really exciting. We have two projects right now we're working on in partnership with the province where we own at the federal level, sort of we own the policy, but they have the touch point. So I think that's really interesting. Applying behavioral science earlier on in the process, I'll admit again, right now we're new, so we're trying to get some projects, some RCTs completed, but what I'd really like to start focusing on is how do we apply it earlier on when a policy idea just gets first tabled? How can we apply a behavioral lens to that policy or program? And then finally, what David Halpern mentioned this morning, which is where they are now, he feels, in the UK, which is when it's really truly embedded in how they do government, I think. So that what's next is more like what's in 5 to 10 years, but it's still, I like to add it there just as a placeholder that hopefully we'll get to a point where that becomes just common. So thank you. I look forward to your questions.
Okay, so if we can all go and sit. You'll need to keep the microphone.
Do you want these slides yet? Or at the very end?
Now is good. Okay. Thank you. So because I'm moderating, I get to ask the first couple of questions, and there's nothing you guys can do about it. Sorry. My questions, I guess, reveal something slightly about myself in terms of how old I am and how nerdy I am. So my first question is drawn from the film Ocean's 11. It's a great film if you haven't seen it. And in that film, Brad Pitt is explaining to Matt Damon how to basically con your way into a conversation with somebody. He says you make eye contact, but not too much eye contact. You're like, you're warm, you're friendly, you shake hands, but not too firmly, not for too long. And the most important thing, and then he gets distracted. And so I'm trying to avoid that happening here. So the first question is, if you were to be imparting one piece of wisdom to everybody else in the room who wants to set up a new behavioral insights team or new behavioral insights function, what would that one piece of advice be?
Persistence is key. There are days when you sort of think, I think, and maybe you won't relate to this, but that this is never going to happen, and that I'm actually never going to use the mic. I said persistence. So there are days where you sort of feel like, oh my gosh, this is never going to happen, or I'm the only person who wants this, sometimes I feel. So I think you have to remember that there is a light and that other governments have succeeded. You will succeed as well. That's, I guess, mine.
I'd say check your own attitude first. I came from academia to administration, and I still suffer a lot, the hardship of bureaucracy. But on the other hand, my colleagues who have been there have done an amazing job also, and they're facing the same hardships. And appreciating what's already out there, the expertise and the goodwill, and align with that and bring them into or step into their boat instead of dragging them along with you. So appreciation is a really basis for cooperation.
I'm tempted to say, be careful what you wish for, because we have not had the problem of a lot of resistance. We have had a lot of support and enthusiasm from Australian government departments. So I think our big challenge is building the capacity to handle the demand and getting the calibration right there so that we don't create expectations that we can't fulfill.
Great. Those are all great answers, although I think we all would wish to have quite so much enthusiasm and be careful what you wish for. So the second question, which again reveals something about me, so this, for those of you who don't know, is Spock. This is the dearly departed Leonard Nimoy, whose catchphrase, for want of a better word, is live long and prosper. And so we're in sort of 6 years now, roughly, post the formation of the UK Behavioural Insights Team. We're obviously 30 or 40 years into the existence of us as a field. And you guys and other units around the world are going to really be the future. So what does living long and prospering look like? What do you guys, at BX22, let's say, what do you hope is going to be, you've already answered this a little bit, what do you think is going to be the things we're talking about being excited about happening next then?
So I think I mentioned this a bit in my presentation, the working with different levels of government. I have this like vision in my mind, or this idea that we've got, you know, a room where all three levels kind of sit together, where you've got federal and provincial and municipal all working together in the common space to solve problems together. I think that that would be sort of my vision. The other thing, as I mentioned, just the applying it earlier on in the process and it being embedded in the way government does business.
Yeah. I think you're very generous on your shirking responsibility.
Saving time for myself.
Yes, very smart. One thing we learned in the process is how important it is to understand how the different organizations really work on the formal and informal processes. And in order to make research more effective within politics, it's really necessary for researchers to understand how our processes in administration working. So for the three researchers we hired, that was their biggest learning in the beginning, of really to understand how do people work, what are the restrictions, what are the possibilities, what are the freedoms, and so on. And my hope is that by this line of work, we can really go a next step in the relationship between science and politics and administration, and have a deeper understanding of how we tick, how we work, and so make give research a strong impact.
That's similar, I guess, to what I was going to say. I think for me is sort of to imagine that we could move to a place with policymaking where the need for incorporating research in the policy design and testing stage before scaling up is taken for granted. That's the default. That, you know, what we're doing is essentially we're bundling, you know, these two things that I think are really important, which is smarter policy design using the best new research from behavioral science, and then the best empirical approach to establishing an evidence base for policy. So randomized control trials as being the gold standard. And so we bundled those two things together as the things that we do. And I think if we can establish that these are things that can be done generally for all areas of policy reform and new policy design and development, and that, you know, we get to a stage that that David talked about where cabinet ministers and secretaries of departments are saying, well, this new policy proposal is okay, but it hasn't been vetted in the way that we think it should. It should have an RCT, and it should have, you know, an application of behavioral, the best in behavioral science. And that's the expectation, not the new thing. That would be my idea.
Okay, so that's all the questions I have. Is there a way I can get rid of Spock, Robert?
Yeah.
first question.
Can I just pick up?
No, mics? We're good over there.
Okay, excellent. Just speak.
I understand you guys set up the units, your units using, well, it was difficult, but now it's a four-way unit and you got some funding. I wonder if you can share some insights on how to get outside funding for conducting trials or innovations.
That's not something that we've resorted to or have a plan to approach.
No, we do work with academics, but that's not a funding relationship. We work with external academics, but I don't know what, if you have any.
Yes, government, we have to be very careful because this might look like sponsoring and like supporting someone else's objectives. So sometimes we work together with a third party just in order to implement, and we make sure that we are transparent who's contributing what. So as a third party party would, I don't know, send out letters, we make sure that somewhere we're transparent about this part and what's his objectives in the whole game. So you want to be very careful of outside money coming into government, because we need to be very transparent on this.
One of the young ladies in the second back row.
My name is Marianne Bates. I'm with Jay Powell's North America office. And I was curious to hear, so the motivation for this question is that we launched our North America office about the same time that the U.S. Social Behavioral Sciences team got started. And I was curious to hear your perspective on how those of us who sit primarily within academia can best support some of the new efforts that you're doing. So I was struck particularly that the examples from Australia seem to have some constraints in terms of capacity and delivering in the next year. What kinds of things would be most useful? The things that we have done here in the U.S. range from, you know, helping to matchmake with a network of academics who can come in and provide support on specific projects, to telling stories and helping share examples from around the world of how this has been done in other cases, to actually seconding staff and creating specific resources on accessing administrative data and that sort of thing. But I'd be curious to hear, I'm guessing there are many of us in the room here who would be happy to be supportive of these kinds of efforts. What would be most helpful to you in getting past some of the constraints you're currently facing?
Yeah, so I know J-PAL really well, Rachel in particular, and the matchmaking model, in fact, is that I've been trying to incorporate it at Beta is the same one that I'm familiar with at J-PAL, in terms of we've been trying to organize events where we get interested scholars together to talk about the projects that we're likely to be working on, and to see whether there might be good matches there, where because ultimately we are hoping to do stuff that is path-breaking enough and with a level of rigor that will be publishable in academic journals. So I think, that's the kind of matchmaking we're looking for, where there are scholars who are experts in an area of policymaking or program design or behavior, and they would like to design something. They need an implementing partner to work with, and we have 14 of them that are ready to go. And so we have a real potential to address something that they think is very interesting and important, and combine it in a randomized control trial. And they would play a role as a co-PI or co-author and do some design work. And at the end of it, we'd have a publishable paper. So I think we actually have a capacity for bringing in visiting scholars on visits if necessary, or to stay with us for 6 months and work with us if necessary. But we can also work remotely with scholars who are just interested in the area and would like to do some of the design work on the study.
So I'd say very similar. As I mentioned, I'd say 9 times out of 10, if not more, if not every time, we work with outside academics to help us design our interventions. I will admit that right now my pool's a bit small, so happy to have more academics who are interested in working with us join us. As I mentioned, team of two, so the more people, the better. And certainly interested in some comments to our organization as well. That's something I will be looking at in the next year. How can we sort of, similar to what the White House team has done, have brought sort of experts in on temporary sort of basis to do some work for a bit. they learn, we learn, everybody sort of wins, so things like that. And we can also talk offline later if that's of interest.
2 points. First is accessibility. I left academia 10 years ago, and the way you research or you search for research is very different today. I'm an outsider, although I've continually tried to stay on track on topics. So it's really like a closed environment if you're not one of an insider. It's so difficult just to find empirical findings on one question you have. So that's something I'm trying to drop wherever I am in science. How can we bring together the empirical findings we do have and make it accessible? Second thing is really to start a discussion about the ethical side of this approach and about the role that science plays in advising politics. You can apply that very good on the advice that we as being units within the government give towards our peers within administration. So from Max Weber on the technocratic model of who's setting objectives, who's choosing the means, who's implementing, who has which responsibility towards a much more sophisticated approach that, for example, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change developed, of seeing that this is really an intermingled process. Yes, there is a democratically elected government who is choosing goals, but also by advising them with scientific research, you might have to realign your objectives just because you see that it doesn't work that way. And so you have an intermingling of science and scientific advice, of the advice that we as administration give, of politicians, and so on. So there is a strong ethical side to that, and all these criticism of manipulation and of interventionism and so on, they are valid, and we have to deal with them and really look at our institutional settings and publishing in a peer-reviewed paper, transparency and all these things is what most of our units really keen on in order to show we don't want to do an inside job in administration and put our own political goals and no one knows about it. That's really not what we want to do. We want to bring methodology and science into administration, but then we have to be transparent that this is really what we want to do.
Young gentleman there.
So on this issue of integrating academics into your work, I'm interested on the other side of the coin. What do academics do when they approach you or when they're working with you that makes your life more difficult? What do they fail to realize about your situation? And what might be a list of do's and don'ts for academics seeking to integrate their work into what you do?
Ideally, a short list of do's and don'ts.
I think for me, sometimes I'm approached and they have a very, very narrow focus. They want to look at tax, low income, people living in the south of, you know, and I think understanding that even especially for the first project, maybe being a little open, I try to match interests with projects, but sometimes it doesn't really always work that way. So being a little more open to the fact that this is what I have right now that could be of interest. I think sometimes academics have a difficult time translating their work to real government situations. I remember this one intervention that was designed, and it was red font, it was bold, there was explanation marks, there was language we would generally not use. It was like, you know, that's okay, that's what we're doing, we're pushing the boundaries. And I go in for approvals, and no way. 45 minutes on an exclamation mark about whether we can have that in government correspondence or not. Anyway, I actually sort of, in the moment, had to concede on a few points, but kept the general sense. Like, I'm pretty firm on I don't change the work, but this was 45 minutes on an exclamation mark. I'm like, forget it, we don't need it. But then just understanding that that's the reality. So when I come out of the briefing, this is what we're going with. I'm, you know, and understanding that there has to be a little bit of flex in there. I'm trying to think. I've always had really positive experiences, though. Academics are really responsive. They email me all the time, like 24 hours a day. I'm not worried about that. They work really hard, good work ethic. So that's the sort of the positive side. I think that's really all I have. It's a flexibility part.
I've got massive selection bias because I've only really approached people. We haven't fielded a bunch of like unsolicited proposals for research. So we tend to pick people who have a good sense of what would be a good applied piece of research that would be scalable, that would sort of fit with government priorities. But I think the potential, if we ask for proposals, would be a bunch of stuff that addresses really narrow issues that are theoretically interesting, but are not really urgent priorities for a government that would need to scale something to affect an outcome. So, but we tend to approach people who have a good sense of policy priorities. So,
yeah, all of this, and then also just as much as little as administration is value free, science is value free, and to lay out your normative thinking would be helpful. Just to give an example. The blind application, it sounds like a great idea, and it is. It has a normative aspect. The reference point is you choose by performance. So that seems just. So, but if you want to raise the percentage of migrants in the working environment in Germany, what happened is with blind applications is the rate sank. And why did it sink? Because they have less opportunity in the education sector at this moment. So what you would like to do is rather raise the percentage, or give them a second chance, or by knowing this person has a migrant background, he might need another year, but then he's just performing as the others, and so on. So I'm not saying I'm against blind application, but just to show there is different normative reference points that you have in your research, that we have in administration, and we want to make sure to reflect on that and to do it openly.
I'm going to go for the control group from the random selection earlier. That's you.
Thank you. My name is Julia Featherstone. I think my question is primarily for Michael, but Andrea and Elizabeth, I'd love to hear your take. Michael, my question is about failure. So when you pre-register trials and say you'll be transparent about the results, some of those trials will probably fail in the sense that they won't deliver the expected results. That's a good thing. Like, much better the trial fails than the policy fails, but you can see why agencies might not feel the same way.
Yep.
Like, how do you have that conversation with them?
Yeah, so I think it's a really important point, and we've been preparing the ground quite a bit, especially in the courses I teach, about why pre-registering is so important and why the publication bias or file drill problem is like a big problem generally, and but particularly within the government service in terms of things that are just reported internally, not even distributed widely internally, just kept on people's desks. So we know it's going to be. It is going to affect our selection of projects probably, and David Halpern has talked about this, and that this is probably in the early stages at least. It's very hard to do this on headline policy initiatives where a minister is committed to do something very quickly. So, but below the headline projects, whether especially about service delivery, there just is a huge area of work that we could do that where people are not going to be like horribly upset about finding that something doesn't work. I think everyone will accept that that's a great thing to know, and that no one is, politically at least, so invested in it publicly that it would be a horrible thing. But it is, we actually have a prime minister now who's talked, publicly about the importance of failing early and learning quickly. And so there's a sense now, I think, in government circles at least, that is something that we should all be thinking about, and we should just be grown-ups about that, right? And it requires the leaders to step up and say, I can say I don't know what the best thing to do is, and I'm not sure whether this works, and there's uncertainty, and that's fine, but we have a way of testing and getting that knowledge, and that's what we do.
So for me, it's all about delivery. So there was a trial that we were working on, and in the briefing, there was about 30 senior officials in the room, and we were about to launch the trial, and they said, so Liz, what do you think is going to happen? Like, what do you think is the result? And I never give a number, and I just say, I don't know. That's what we're doing here. We don't know what's going to work. We don't know. And so someone down at the end of the table said, we predict about a 90% increase. 90. So I just about fell over, and it's a huge long table. I lean over. I don't think we're going for 90. And in my mind, like, not even, you know. And then someone else said, well, everything that Liz's team does, it just works. And now that's hanging in the room. So I said, okay, let's just, like, manage expectations. Sure enough, didn't work. Didn't do anything. So I have to go back and say, okay, it didn't work. But for me, it's all about tabling the what's next. So we walk in, we say, you know what, this didn't work, but this is what we know. We know now not to spend money on this, and we're suggesting now we try this. So it's coming in with the next game plan. This is what we learned, like, sort of like, okay, getting over it. So we know that this kind of message has no impact. So now let's try this. But it happens, and it's part of the learning, and just you kind of hope that the organization is supportive of that, and they haven't released a press release prior to about the trial.
I had one really, I know we're out of time, but there's one really interesting tension that I think we all face that we have to be upfront about too, is that, and it's part, you know, there's two things that we're bundling together, the insights, application of insights, and the testing. And there's a little bit of tension because, in a sense, like we're saying, these insights really work. You know, we'll add value by applying these things, we'll improve stuff for you. But then we test because we're not 100% sure, right? And so there's a little bit of tension there, and we just have to be very upfront about that too. And that's why in the selection of projects, I think there are some quick wins that are probably obvious wins, and we're just measuring the extent to which we make an improvement. And then there are some harder cases where I think we have to be a little bit, you know, more honest about the uncertainty that we have, that we know what the answer is and we just have to apply it. And that's where the testing is really critical, and we may expect to fail a certain percentage of the time.
So because we started 5 minutes late, and all the other sessions did as well, we're going to run 5 minutes late. I'm not keeping you from your lunch, I promise. Yes. So I think we have time, if we're okay with one more, a very reasonably brief answer, and then one more question, as long as it's a short question. Ideally with a numerical answer. so do you want to answer quickly? And you guys can sift among yourselves who do you think's got the shortest question.
Yeah, I can't add too much just by being open, telling it beforehand that this is what can happen, and then also we have kind of an agreement. If we cooperate, this is what we do, we're going to publish the results no matter what the results are, and what you do with it is up to you. And we are going to do an evaluation once we implement what we suggest, so we make sure that the expectations are clear. And it's most of the times our cooperation partner has just one policy option in his mind. He wants to be tested. And so just in the process of talking with them, we open their minds to more options. So we always, if a trial would show there's no result, then they already had in the back of their minds there's other options.
Okay. Who's got a very short question? None of you, you all have long questions. Lady at the back.
I think it's short enough. I started the first nudge consulting unit in France. I have one third of my clients is government and the two thirds are private sector. So my question for you is, how do you see the link between government and public sector in terms of nudging? Because as your units are going to develop, there may be companies that will come and be like, hey, can you help us design this type of, is that short enough? Like, how do you see the future?
Yeah, that's good. Oh, good. Oh, thanks. Yeah, yeah.
Sounds like a really good PhD question.
That's short.
Yeah. Okay, so can we have very short answers to that question?
So, honestly, I can't see a situation in which we're sitting in the Government of Canada and able to sort of consult, if that's what you mean, with the private sector. I can't see that happening. I think... perhaps sort of the UK model where they sort of left, like they left the government and then now they can, that's different. But sitting in government, we wouldn't consult with privacy. We might partner with them on something.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
So, okay, so like for instance, if I want to achieve a desired outcome and I want to use like our telecommunications company to do it. Okay, sorry, yes. That's certainly something. The difficulty is always in the motivation. So, as an example, hydro companies, you know, we want people to conserve hydro, but then hydro companies a lot of the time are in the business of making money. So just that, how do we work with them to get them to sort of want to reduce usage? And in some situations, they're motivated. So in some communities, there might be a water shortage, so then the water company is very motivated to have people use less. So I think that can be tricky. But we are looking at some partnerships, but nothing has gone too far down the line. I don't know if you might have more.
No, I'm tempted to give a really long answer and keep everyone for lunch, but no, I think we're in the same boat.
Yeah, just the same. Really have to be careful whom you cooperate with, what are their motives, and whether you can make transparent what's the interest on each side. So we try to stick to academia at this point or to public authorities, especially now in the beginning that we implement this approach. Really don't want to raise too much suspicion and too much criticism, which is unnecessary, and so there is very good ground rules on how government can cooperate with private sector, and simply by following them, we make sure we're on the safe side.
Okay. So thank you all for being here, and thank you for your questions, and thank you to our speakers.